Good morning, Your Honor. Donald Falk for Appellant Lieutenant Colonel Jonathan Dunn. I'd like to start by reserving 8 minutes for rebuttal in hopes that maybe there's four or five left by the time I sit down, at least three.
Sounds good.
May it please the court, this appeal can and should be decided because Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's entitlement to preliminary relief presents a refusal to afford a religious accommodation that goes beyond the class-wide claims at issue in the Doster case in the Sixth Circuit. He can't opt out from that mandatory class, but well, this court can give him...
This may not affect what we really do end up doing, but the class certification order of the Ohio judge specifically says that he can.
Yes, Your Honor, and the Supreme Court says that he can't. My understanding of what's at issue in that case is that there are people that have applied, that went through this process of applying for religious exemptions who want to get out. And I think the proper way to look at when you look at what the Supreme Court said in Dukes and what the rules say, that B1 and a B2 class, there can't be opt-outs. But I think what's really happening here is that he's opening a door for people who want to get out of the service, who are already, you know, 3 feet out the door, three toes out the door, to be able to waive the relief without having the military, the Air Force, be contempt or violating the injunction. I mean, under B1 and B2, the Supreme Court's been crystal clear on that.
So what's the implication of that? That this appeal is moot?
No, it's not moot at all, Your Honor, for several reasons. I mean, it's certainly the appeal isn't moot because the relief in Doster could go away at any moment. For Lieutenant Colonel Dunn, the Sixth Circuit could go along with the government's request and stay the preliminary injunction in full. It could stay the class certification and just allow the injunction to go forward with respect to the named plaintiffs. But most important, Lieutenant Colonel Dunn has claims, I think the very strong claims that go beyond anything at issue in Doster, which is as presented right now, essentially is...
So your position is that we should go ahead and decide this?
Our position is that you should go ahead and decide this. This is a permanent...
If we decided it against your client, what would be the consequence of that?
The consequence might not ripen until something happens in Doster, but if the injunction, preliminary injunction, is limited in Doster, and certainly if he wouldn't have the protection of his own injunction. I think he's got stronger grounds for a preliminary. Frankly, I mean, I respect what they're doing in Doster. I think they've litigated it very well. But we do have a factor here, the natural immunity factor, which I think really goes far beyond what has been so far presented on a class-wide basis.
You have more than in Doster, but if Doster goes the right way for your client, it will give him all of the relief that he is asking for, just on a narrower or less ground. So why wouldn't the right course to be to sit back, even though you believe your client has stronger claims, more arguments, why wouldn't it be to sit back, see what happens in Doster, and then only address those extra things if Doster goes in a way that's adverse to your client and therefore actually makes it relevant? Because you have arguments that they don't have in Doster, but you also are getting all of the relief. Make sure I'm clear. You're not arguing that you're not going to get all your relief that you want from Doster if Doster stays in its current, if it continues in the way it is now.
Well, there are some issues with the way the injunction has been implemented, and so I think we would address at least one aspect of what has been going on in the Air Force after Doster. Yes, the preliminary relief, I mean, and our last 28J said, the court may want to wait and see. We don't think the court has to wait and see, and frankly, I'm not sure that the court should wait and see. But, I mean, certainly it is certainly for, I mean, as a matter of jurisprudential caution, it is,
Are we even allowed to wait and see? That is to say, the rules around abstention are fairly strict, actually, so that I think the general rule is if there is parallel litigation, each side is supposed to go forward. They're not supposed to abstain. And then once one of the litigations get to the point where there's preclusive effect, well, the game's over, or at least to the extent there's preclusion. But so long as both cases are proceeding, I don't think either court is allowed to abstain.
I think that's right, Your Honor. I mean, I've certainly seen courts do things. I mean, then timing of decisions and to arrange things. I think as a matter
I see them do it, but to the extent there's case law on the point, they're not supposed to.
No, I agree with that, Your Honor. That's why our first position is you should decide this. We understand the court may have, you know, the court decided instead of postponing the argument a little bit to move it up a little bit. So I understand I think Your Honor, Judge Fletcher, you're completely right as a matter of what a court is supposed to do. There can't be preclusive effect on a preliminary order to begin with. We're looking at preliminary relief here, which I think is, you know, an important part of this context. The context here, we are asking for relief that will allow Lieutenant Colonel Dunn to seek out a commander who will take him during the pendency of his action. Obviously, if he wins on a permanent injunction or benefits from the preclusive effect of another permanent injunction, then he's in great shape. And if he loses, then the preliminary relief is gone.
What is Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's current status? What is he doing? What is he not allowed to do? We've had some funky things happen here in the interim.
Yes, pardon me for making sure I have my notes straight on this, because he is back reporting in theory, at least. I don't know whether a date has come up yet at March Air Force Base. Obviously, is not in the same position. He's been put in a position as senior executive officer, which is administrative position, and that's what he would report to. He has been under the orders he has will limit him to sort of the minimum reserve reporting, to weekend a month and 2 weeks a year. It caps the points he can earn, but he is off no points, no pay. He is, no disciplinary paperwork has proceeded beyond what's in the record. And that's about it. He is subject to the operational limit that the one thing that has gone into effect that we would at least raise for this court's consideration, though maybe something for the district court to consider upon remand should this court agree with us, is that there the operational limit that has been placed on the class limits travel. Lieutenant Colonel Dunn, we pointed out in our briefs that travel is one of the more safe things for someone with natural immunity. In particular, Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's an airline pilot. I mean, travel is safe for people in his position. So that is the one little nitpick that we've got with what's been happening so far. The terms of the injunction, we think, are...
So he is going into March Air Force Base?
Yeah, I don't believe he's made it yet. It's just, you know, the doster just was extended to the class a week ago, but he has been told that that's what he's going to be doing. He will be going into March, weekend a month, and presumably when the 2 week
and doing what? Handling paper?
Essentially, he says he describes it as a senior executive officer, which he says is a fancy name for a high ranking secretary.
Okay.
But I mean, it's something that, you know, I don't know, disrespect to the people who that's their job. I mean, he's got a position for the moment. Obviously, he'd probably prefer to do something else,
allow him to get all of his benefits if he finishes out the next, whatever it is, 18 months.
Yeah. I mean, he is off no points, no pay. He has an assignment. No points, no pay takes him off an assignment. The individual ready reserve would have a complete gap in service. So this this means he does have an assignment. And, you know, although obviously it may not be as beneficial to him as his former command, it is an assignment be considered.
And what are you asking the court to do today? So if you win today, what are you asking our order to look like?
Well, we tried to draft it in our conclusion to the reply brief as closely as we'd like. I mean, I do think for someone in his position with natural immunity that the travel ban, although it, you know, doesn't seem to stop him, we don't think, from getting to reporting to March Air Force Base, the ban on military travel, maybe we think that's misguided, and perhaps either this court or the district court in remand should address that. But otherwise, I think we spelled out what we want. Oh. He's not getting his command back. We know that. We don't dispute that. He's not going back under Colonel Haynes or Colonel Haynes'
successor.
You're
not asking for any particular assignment, right?
Absolutely not, Your Honor.
And what, he has an assignment, it sounds like.
He has an assignment. He would like, you know, he wants the freedom to, and he, as we said, he believes that he can find and has found perhaps a commander who would take him in a different assignment. But, you know, right now he's back in an assignment. And so what we want is that there's no categorical preclusion upon his ability to look for, you know, an assignment for a commander who'll take him.
If we were to affirm the denial of the PI, what consequences would that have to Lieutenant Colonel Dunn?
If anything happens in Doster, he's going to be,
But the bottom line is nothing, right? Nothing changes if we affirm the denial of the preliminary injunction. He still has his desk job.
No, excuse me, Your Honor. Go ahead. Go ahead. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, Your Honor.
There's been a lot of this case has not been as clean as you might have liked it to be. If we affirm the district court, deny the stay of the refuse to issue the preliminary injunction. Okay, then what happens to Lieutenant Colonel Dunn? Does he still go to the reserves once or twice a month? He still have his senior executive officer position?
If nothing happens in Doster, I believe that would be the case.
Okay. Now, if Doster went south on him, then, and we were to affirm the district court, then what would happen? Is it clear what would happen, or is it not clear?
Well, I think it's pretty clear because there was a brief period when this court entered interim relief when considering the motion for an injunction pending appeal, and when that was denied, they pushed him. They took steps. He had already been relieved of command and didn't have a current assignment, but he didn't get an assignment. They took several steps towards placing him. They put him on no points, no pay. They took several steps towards placing him on the individual ready reserve. So I think it is fair to say, and I don't think the other side would contest this, that were the injunction, the preliminary injunction in Doster to be lifted, that he would be ordered not to report, he would lose his assignment, and he would be back where he was when we were briefing this case on the merits. And which is why.
Could he be dismissed from the military?
He could be. I mean, they say at 328 that administrative discharge is something that happens to people in his position. It may happen to people in his position. They have so far, to my knowledge, and I think I'm up to date on this, that they have initiated and said they would put him on individual ready reserve, which is the last step before you're out the door. But they certainly have said, as a matter of policy, that a discharge would be possible, and I think that's one of the reasons that there is no harm, and perhaps it's just Judge Fletcher says a duty to look at this preliminary injunction separately, and in our view, to provide Lieutenant Colonel Dunn with the protection, the additional protection that his own case warrants, while his case goes forward.
So can I ask the next question? Maybe Judge Bybee was going to ask this, but what happens if we were to grant the relief that you're requesting, and how does that what does that do for him if Doster stays the way it is now? Is there anything additional he would get? It sounds like you have this little travel thing, but put that aside or not.
No, I don't think it's trivial, Your Honor, but I don't think it would change much on the ground, to be honest, Your Honor. I don't think it would change much on the ground.
Doster stays, and we grant.
And he stays.
It's sort of, he's getting kind of belt and suspenders, it sounds like.
It's belt and suspenders, but it's preliminary relief, Your Honor. And this is where, I mean, things can happen in either case in either time, at any time. And I don't think in parallel litigation, belt and suspenders is something that's a bad thing. I think in this case, because... until we see at least how Doster is going to be litigated in the district court and permanent proceedings, there's no separation among those who have natural immunity, and I think that that really changes the calculus on both compelling interest and least restrictive means, that that indeed Lieutenant Colonel Dunn would get additional protection. And again, I think the travel, our issue with the travel is limited to people with natural immunity. We're not arguing for anybody else because it's an individual case under RFRA. It's an individual case, and we've got someone, we've got a plaintiff who we think meets the standards for safe travel.
So I'm just trying to, like, so you kind of gaming this out, the four different options between Doster and this case. It sounds like the real significant difference for your client, if we rule in this case, is in that in the last alternative where Doster goes in a different direction or something on appeal, and then and if we were to rule in favor of your client, now your client's protected by our ruling, but is not protected anymore by the Doster ruling, and that's where you have a very significant difference for your
that's
client.
That's the most significant difference, Your Honor. Obviously, I mean,
only,
yes.
I mean, it's the only one, right? Like, I mean, it's, I think the other ones, like the other ones, it sounds to me like you were saying, if we got, it's almost like you're implicitly saying, if we got to this position, that's why those other ones matter. So if Doster, if you know, if Doster continues to protect your client, and we were to rule in the way that, you know, and we were to reverse the district court, that isn't going to do anything for your client unless Doster goes away. So that is the only, isn't that? I mean, I'm just trying to make sure I'm. It's the only time when it really, this case makes a big difference for your client is if Doster goes away.
Or a lot of things happen in Doster besides it going away, Your Honor. If there's a limitation on the class for preliminary purposes, either a stay of the preliminary injunction or on appeal, if the case goes back down in Doster, and a lot of things can happen in Doster besides a strict reversal that would affect Lieutenant Colonel Dunn. And we think that given the given the military's record of actions in this case, and generally with respect to people in his position, that he deserves and warrants the extra protection of an injunction that covers him based on his particular circumstances as he litigates his particular claim. Now, I'm going to focus on RFRA because I think it's more efficient. And the question is whether the defendants have established so uniquely, a compelling interest that's so uniquely served by vaccination that no religious accommodation is necessary, even for those like Lieutenant Colonel Dunn with natural immunity. And sincerity and burden are undisputed at this stage. So we're really looking at whether just the least restrictive means, whether vaccination of someone who's had COVID are the least restrictive means to achieve a compelling government interest. And that's all their burden, and they can't carry it.
So why do we get to compelling state interest? What do you do with our decision in Doe that looks pretty similar to this one, except for the fact, Doe versus San Diego School
yes,
District.
Yes, yeah, I
except for the fact that here, instead of having a school district, we've got the military, which traditionally gets more deference from the courts. And in Doe, there was no strict scrutiny at all. It was just rational basis. How do you get away from that in Doe?
I got away from that in Doe by saying that I'm focusing on RFRA and not on the First Amendment. Doe's a First Amendment case. It didn't involve the federal government. RFRA didn't apply. The RLUIPA didn't apply. I forgot the rest of the acronym. And so RFRA, under RFRA, strict scrutiny applies. And under Doe, I mean, I'm happy to talk about the First Amendment, but I think in the limited, if with the court's indulgence and limited time here, I think RFRA is the cleaner path to success here because we have a mandated strict scrutiny standard that does apply to the military. This was an exercise of Congress's powers to enact rules for the military, and it applies here.
Yeah, so there's this kind of oddness that in the First Amendment context, the narrow tailoring part seems to have kind of crept into the first step of whether strict scrutiny applies because they'll end up deciding whether or not something is generally applicable or not by trying to decide whether or not there's exceptions, right? And then you knock out, you know, that's what in Doe, they knocked out the exceptions by saying, yeah, but this isn't really an exception that counts, and this is an exception that counts. And so to Judge Fletcher's question, you know, that analysis from Doe, I mean, one could try to carry that over into the narrow tailoring requirement for RFRA. Any thoughts on that?
Well, yeah, lots of thoughts on that, Your Honor. I don't think that the I agree that we end up talking about the same facts and how they work, but I think they work differently under strict scrutiny under the RFRA in the RFRA context. I mean, Doe again was saying there's no strict scrutiny because the exceptions aren't really exceptions. And here, you know, I guess let me focus on the exceptions. Let me talk about the merits for a minute here, Your Honor. I think the exceptions here do underline, do undermine the government's case, both for compelling interest and for least restrictive means. And they do so for several reasons. I mean, the medical administrator, the very fact that there are these different types of exceptions, I think not just medical exceptions. I think undermines the
pregnancy exception is not really a medical exception because their argument because CDC says you can get the vaccine if you're pregnant is my understanding. Is that right?
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, so their argument there is that it's temporary. As I understand it, the government is relying significantly on the fact that all of their other exceptions are arguably temporary, whereas their view is that religious people aren't going to change their religious views very easily, so the religious exemptions would not be temporary. That seems to me where they're putting a lot of their weight. What do you think of that?
They are putting a lot of their weight in on that, and I think what we have here is a request for preliminary relief, and there's no reason to think this case won't move along quite quickly. Pregnancy is of course temporary, but it's a lot of months, and also there's another exception. You see at ER 136. For clinical trials, where certainly people in those trials, some of them aren't going to have placebos or other ineffective medical agents, which in clinical trials can go on for quite some time. So what we're looking at, and
how does that work with a clinical trial? So if they do a clinical trial and they got the placebo, when it's all over, do they say, you got the placebo, so now you need to go get vaccinated? Is that how that works? Or do they just never know? Like they always think they got the vaccine, but they got a placebo.
I think they eventually tell you you got a placebo. I don't know the answer to that question. That's my understanding from people that have, you know, serious illnesses that are in clinical trials, that at the end of the clinical trial, that study period, that they get treatment if they haven't had treatment or they haven't responded to placebo. I can't answer the clinical trials in this case. I would guess that that's highly likely that they get treatment.
It kind of matters because that would actually cut against their temporary argument, because if the people that were in military trials that got a placebo never actually got vaccinated, then it probably wouldn't be because they thought they'd been vaccinated, and it wouldn't be temporary.
Well, I think that's a great issue to be explored on remand, Your Honor. Unfortunately, I don't have a straight answer for you today. I just don't know.
So what month and year did he get COVID?
I believe it was July, last July.
Okay, so in July of 2021?
Correct.
And what is the science on the length of for natural immunity? How long does it last?
Well, the science, and this is another place where it's difficult for them to carry their burden, the science is still developing on how long. What's pretty clear is it lasts longer than vaccination immunity. I think that's pretty overwhelmingly established. The precise degree and exactly how long.
And does the natural immunity apply to variants?
The Bhattacharya and Nukasham declarations explained that you would at least expect, and I think the early returns and studies suggest that natural immunity is more effective against variants for the reason that when the body reacts to the SARS-CoV virus, it reacts in a more complete manner. The vaccines that we have here are not the traditional vaccines where you are infected, but they directly affect the body's production of a particular protein targeted to a particular virus. So the natural immunity, we have a basis to expect, and I think the data so far suggests that it is more effective against variants. The precise amount I think is unclear, but the balance is surely on our side on that.
Does a vaccine interfere with natural immunity?
I don't think
the belt does. The belt interfere with the operation of the suspenders.
This is an area where there is very little research that has been published, and I think there'll be a lot more. It does not.
Okay.
I am unaware of anything saying that it interferes with that a vaccination on someone who is naturally immune interferes with natural immunity. There, it is unclear whether it is a measurable improvement over what is pretty strong protection, at least as strong protection as the mandate here. Recall the mandate here, which is all we're looking at, doesn't require boosters. It's just the initial. It's just the initial course, and so I think natural immunity stacks up extremely well.
Right. Is there
I
any,
think overwhelmingly
is there better, any,
but
is there any science as to whether the a vaccine, in addition to natural immunity, provides any marginal benefit?
There were early studies that suggested that. I am unaware, and it doesn't mean they don't exist. I am unaware of studies that have you know, taken the Delta and Omicron variants. I mean, the science is changing on this as the disease changes.
Can I ask a related question? I know your time, but
I'm here for you.
Kind of a related question, because I think one of Judge Bybee's questions earlier was, is there any evidence that if you've got natural immunity and then you get vaccinated, if it hurts your natural immunity? I think that was, and I thought I remember seeing in one of the amicus briefs that there was some study that showed, but I'm sure there's studies that go the other way. What do we do? It's sort of a question to, what do we do if there's, with the evidence on these things in the record? I mean, in theory, we do give deference as Judge Fletcher was saying, typically to the government's weighing of these kind of studies. How does that play out here?
Well, you give deference in certain contexts, but the deference can't be sweeping, or it would nullify RFRA itself. I mean, the government in the military traditionally says the need for uniformity is enough to override in almost anything anybody wants to challenge. And if that's so, RFRA is a dead letter, and so is anything else that Congress says. Here, I think with the balance of evidence here, you look at the government's interest, and the government's interest is not in administering a vaccine. It's in keeping service members from getting sick. And if natural immunity is as good as the mandate,
but that's the whole question: does a vaccine provide some marginal benefit to natural immunity? We have a couple of different questions. One: how long does natural immunity last? How long does a vaccine last? Those are both good questions. Those may not be the same time periods, but we may be in this for several years. And if there is some benefit to be provided and it doesn't interfere with the natural immunity, that is, the vaccine's not working against the body's natural immunity, then it's hard to see why natural immunity alone is just as good as and is a satisfactory alternative. It's an alternative. And before we had a vaccine, it was all we had.
Well, Your Honor, I think for the purpose of deciding whether there is an entitlement to a religious accommodation, if natural immunity is as good as vaccine immunity to the bulk of the force, from the first round, the mandated vaccines, then I think it is close enough to require a. We think the science goes pretty heavily the other way with, as you say, with that specific question. I think the science is still developing, but I think on the record here, it is close enough to require an accommodation. It is not something that we're not asking. Again, we're not saying that the court should order service-wide that no naturally immune service members should be told to be vaccinated. This is the narrow situation where we have a sincere religious objection and a substantial burden conceded at the preliminary stage here. And the question is whether there is going to be a temporary suspension of disciplinary and adverse action against Lieutenant Colonel Dunn.
Here's my problem with this, as it were, line of reasoning, and that is, it's very clear, of course, that we're not experts on the science, neither are you, neither is your client. In a sense, of course, neither is the military, but it does the best it can. But it's the military that has made a judgment that there has to be vaccination, and you can see why they would think that. Whether it's sufficient is another question, but you can see why they would think that, even if natural immunity from having had the disease already and recovered from it is close. For the government to say, the military to say, well, that's good enough, then what happens? I mean, lots of people will say, well, I've had it already, I'm done. and have advanced a religious objection, and then the military is in a pretty difficult position because it's going to have to do all kinds of testing, all kinds of things, and it's decided that it's much more efficient for purposes of military effectiveness to simply require vaccination. Why is that not enough, given the deference that we owe to the military?
Well, I think the deference owed to the military does not sweep broadly enough to justify this. This is something where they are the mandate is something that requires a vaccine that gives minimal protection, which is what the CDC now says, minimal protection, the first round. The CDC recognizes it. It's treating natural immunity and vaccine immunity in the same bucket. I think the Brown decision, the Supreme Court's Brown decision, is affirming this court, and granted in the speech context, but I think it carries over to any kind of strict scrutiny, says that every marginal percentage point is not enough. And here I think it would be one thing if there was if Lieutenant Colonel Dunn had not already had the disease, but he has already had the disease, and he's about the same, maybe a little more protected, but we know the vaccinated people aren't all that protected against getting it again, but it's going to be mild. And so the question is whether the government's interest in forcing a vaccine upon, in this case, one objector, or certainly a limited group of religious objectors, is sufficient to overcome their religious
Counsel,
rights.
Would your answer to Judge Fletcher's question have been different if Lieutenant Colonel Dunn had not been relieved of his command?
Would it have been different? I don't think
your
so.
Answer, is your answer the same if he's commanding a group of highly skilled, very technical people who are dropping in at a very, very early time in a conflict to set up a temporary Air Force base, as opposed to sitting at the desk pushing paper, as he put it?
Well, I think, Your Honor, go ahead.
Doesn't that suggest a different kind of reweighing of the question of the deference to the military?
Well, it reweighs it. I mean, we are not asking for an injunction that goes beyond what was entered in the other Austin case. We're not asking him to be placed in command or any particular assignment. One thing that that part of the government's regulation suggests is that, you know, one of the things they can do for a religious accommodation is a reassignment. And, you know, we recognize, and we're not asking the court to say he had to stay in command. I mean, yes, we asked for status quo and the TRO, but that was moot by the time we got to court. And now I think, you know, with the state of the law right now, we can't ask him, even under the Air Force race, we're not asking him to be reinstated. Whether he can be reassigned? I mean, yeah, he can be reassigned, and that's, I think, what should have happened here. That's really the crux of the issue.
So, counsel, maybe another way of getting at the question that Judge Bybee's asking is it enough for the government to say, you know, there's a whole bunch of jobs in the military that we need, that not being vaccinated for is going to be a problem for that job? And so is that enough for the government, or if it turns out that there's some portion of jobs where not being vaccinated but having natural immunity, I guess to use the facts in this case, would be okay, then how does that, does the government, in order to kick your client out, does the government have to be able to show that he couldn't serve in those jobs too? That's kind of, I think, goes to what Judge Bybee was asking. He's saying, you know, maybe that's a job that he couldn't do.
Right.
I don't know. But you know, I do agree that we probably have to give some deference to the military, that at least some of the jobs. But what do we do? I guess the military's position is, yeah, but every single job, you know, 100% readiness, or, you know, that seems to be their argument. But is that right, or do we look at it at a more granular level and say, no, you have to show that, like, you couldn't accommodate this?
Well, yeah, I think exactly. You have to show that you couldn't accommodate this, just as you would in any other religious accommodation situation. I think the military is trying to, have an all or nothing situation here, where that's not relevant. It shouldn't be relevant at this stage. We're not asking again for him to be maintained in command. I mean, yeah, do I personally think that he could stay? Yeah, I think probably. But, you know, that's not my judgment. It's not the court's judgment. It's not something that we're going to intrude on here. But what I think we can intrude on is the notion that there is nothing he could do. We know there are things he could do. We know that the military, the public interest, in fact, right now, it weighs very heavily in favor of retaining people of his experience and, you know, 19 years of a flawless record and steady record of promotion wherever they can use him. And you know, the military General Berger just last month sent out a memo to the reserves.
Now, Simon, we're way over, but I know that my colleagues probably. I'm not going to cut you off I'm not going to cut you off until my colleagues have been able to ask all their questions. But I think Judge Bybee may have had some other ones. And if Judge,
I'm going to turn the questions just a bit.
Sure.
Judge Fletcher, if you've got questions on this line, I'm going to change lines.
Go ahead.
Okay. I'd like you to turn to the nature of the religious claim at issue here. For purposes of my question, I have no question as to Lieutenant Dunn's sincerity. My questions go beyond the question of sincerity. This is an unusual claim. I cannot remember another case that I have seen in my experience in which the First Amendment ran up against the First Commandment. Can you identify any other case in which the religious claimant said that he was being forced to worship a false god?
Well, I think West Virginia against Barnett is pretty close.
West Virginia versus Barnett, don't even get me started. I've written a law review article on this. It's a free speech case.
Well, yeah, if you're talking about the claim, then Minersville against Gubitis, which is the same claim under the religion clauses. I mean, it was certainly the same claim. There have been
aside from Gubitis, have you got any other case that you can think of that involved a claim that someone's being forced to worship a false god?
I'm happy to talk the theology with you. I'm happy to talk the Book of Esther, which is really close to this.
Does the court have any obligation to inquire into the circumstances under which Lieutenant Colonel Dunn is being forced to worship a false god in his view?
Well, I think since the sincerity of his view was conceded by the chaplain below, I don't think it's there. But I mean, I'm happy if the court wants to inquire in it. I'm happy to point to analogies within the Hebrew scriptures. At least I'm not as familiar with some of the other scriptures.
Let's take the example that you used in your brief and that Lieutenant Colonel Dunn used, which was the example of Daniel.
Yeah.
So Daniel in the court of King Nebuchadnezzar was thrown into the furnace with his friends for failing to worship Nebuchadnezzar's god on command. It would have been common ground between Daniel and Nebuchadnezzar that Nebuchadnezzar had a god different from Daniel's and that he was forcing Daniel to worship that god. Whose god is Lieutenant Colonel Dunn being forced to worship?
Well, I think the closer analogy, I think Daniel's a good analogy, and it's the one that Lieutenant Colonel Dunn
used repeatedly in your briefs.
And of course, we use it repeated in your briefs, but with the benefit of more thought, I think somewhat closer now. I think Daniel's pretty close. I mean, I do think it is the same thing. You're having the government saying, "Bow down to this thing," and we're saying, "I can't bow down to this."
Let me stop there. I mean, who's enforcing him to bow down to this in any other way than any other rules that we have? Stop signs on military bases. Is that a false god? What makes this one a false god, and who created this false god? Who has erected this? Is that Lloyd Austin's fault? Is that President Biden's fault? I'm trying to figure out who erected it. Daniel would have had not only a free exercise claim, he would have had an establishment clause claim. And you haven't got an establishment clause claim, or if you were to bring one, then we would be entitled to ask, who's doing the establishing?
What I think, and I haven't had as deep a theological discussion as I would like with my client, but what I think he is saying it is that he believes that the way that this particular vaccine has gained all kinds of social and political significance and has been forced upon people, that it is an act of worship that amounts to a form of idolatry.
I'm not questioning his sincerity in that belief. What I'm asking is, in the nature of this claim, does the court have any obligation of inquiry as to whether there is someone or something that is forcing a false god?
Well, I think
that would have been an easy answer in the case of Daniel.
Well, I believe that Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's answer would be that to be forced to undergo what strikes him as a ritual of this vaccination is a worship of a non-divine idol. And I think it is...
He doesn't object to any other vaccines.
He does not, because they don't carry the same... There hasn't been... He reached this position after extensive prayer, and there hasn't been... I mean, certainly in my experience, I've never seen anything like this. Perhaps the polio vaccine, but I was too young really to remember that, and I don't remember the compulsion being involved in that. And this strikes him as spiritually different. And I do think there are things, and the vaccine point is the point that I would take from the Book of Esther, where Mordecai refuses to bow down to Haman. Now, there's a ton of discussion in the Hebrew commentaries and the Talmud and elsewhere about, well, yeah, you can acknowledge high-ranking officials in certain ways. You can acknowledge sages as well, and government officials. And in certain ways, there's certain things you can and can't do. But for Mordecai, the way the compulsion of that order turns it into a form of idolatry that goes beyond what's permissible. And I think that I think that's the analogy here. I think the compulsion is quite clear on this record, and it is a
compulsion
matter
is clear with respect to all other vaccines. It would be clear with respect to tropical medicines that members would be forced to get before they'd be sent to certain areas of the world. It's true with respect to all kinds of rules. It was in the Goldman case. It was true with respect to the restriction against religious headgear. We have all kinds of rules that they have to fly. I'm wondering how far this principle extends, because if we're to take simply Lieutenant Dunn's perception of the false god created by someone else, then where does the rule end? If he were subject to Douglas MacArthur, who was regarded as God by both his men and probably by himself, does that mean that Lieutenant Dunn would not be able to salute him in the Haman exhibit because General MacArthur regarded himself as God?
Well, I think
if Esther is your example, that seems to be the problem, doesn't it? And we would then have to run the RFRA gauntlet with respect to everything that Lieutenant Dunn was doing if he was subject to General MacArthur's orders.
Well, I think running the RFRA gauntlet is something that is what RFRA does. I think, in the salute situation, obviously the balancing would come out very differently. I think that there is certainly always a parade of horribles, but I think the law is quite established that, I mean, even with the person who thought the creation of a social security number would steal his daughter's soul, I mean, this is not something that
right.
was widely believed, and in fact very hard to document that anybody else believed it, but it was taken at face value. Did that result? Yes, I mean, I think you could say that could have resulted
right.
in a whole lot of claims, but it
Counsel, but what's
didn't.
What's different about this case is that this is Lieutenant Dunn characterizing the religion of someone else. It's not his own, not just his own religion. But he is saying that someone or something has created a false god, and that's a description about what someone else has done.
It is a description, and I think it is a form. I mean, again, I'm starting to speak really deeply about Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's beliefs in a way that we've discussed this, but I haven't gone into this much depth with him, Your Honor. But my sense is. Is that he feels that this has taken on the characteristics of a state religion, such as one sees in some in a variety of totalitarian societies. Not that this is one, but he sees this as an aspect that is parallel to that, and that it, that has roots in the in some of the societies of the biblical times. You seek analogies, and I think he says the creation of it is it is by the government. I don't think it's just the commander in chief. I think it is the government as a whole, and I think that is the source of his belief. And I don't think it is unusual. I mean, it is rare, but I don't think it is that far an outlier to see that there are some to believe that there are some idolatrous characteristics in some of the things in this is in particulars that the state imposes on individuals.
Your client has said that the vaccination has taken on a symbolic quality,
right,
that he regards as a false god. Yet in the Bladensburg Cross case, which was not a free exercise claim but was an Establishment Clause claim, even though the court acknowledges that a cross does have certain kind of religious symbolic value, the court there was willing to go beyond that and say it's lost that value. It doesn't have that. Same in the Ten Commandments cases out of Texas. Even Justice Breyer was willing to say that it's lost that symbolic religious quality and acquired some broader. So the court has been willing to inquire into the nature of religious symbols and make a judgment about what they represent and what they don't represent. Do we have any similar obligation here?
I don't think you have the obligation in the free exercise context, because in the Establishment Clause context, you're looking at the meaning of an imposition by a government entity, and you're looking at very important what the government is doing, whereas the free exercise jurisprudence has accepted, once you clear the sincerity hurdle, you accepted a fair range of beliefs that are outside the mainstream of all different religions, from Christian to Muslim to Jewish. You have people that believe things not many other people believe, and people who are none of the above, that have very strong spiritual values and religious values and religious traditions that don't actually coincide with what a lot of other people say. On the Establishment Clause, it's a very different analysis, because you're looking at what the government is imposing upon the population, and you have to look at exactly what the government's trying to do. And we're not bringing an Establishment Clause claim. We're not saying that the imposition of the vaccine violates the Establishment Clause, but something someone can have a sincere and redressable belief that is protected by the Free Exercise Clause, and for purposes here by RFRA, that flipped on the other way would not support an Establishment Clause claim. I don't think they're coextensive. There are some overlaps, but I don't think they're coextensive, Your Honor.
I appreciate your answers, Mr. Falk. I realize I probably blindsided you just a bit with this discussion, but thank you for your...
I was waiting for any opportunity to talk about the Book of Esther, Your Honor, so I appreciate it.
I think that Esther was at best probably a CF, maybe a C also, but Daniel did seem to be a C. It seemed to be right on point.
Well, Esther was the lawyer's contribution to the. Okay. It's a little bit. It looms a little larger in the Hebrew Bible than in the Christian Bible, but it did seem to be a good analysis. Daniel, I mean, I'll stand by the Daniel analysis. I've said what I have to say.
Okay.
Counsel, have you or your client familiar with like Herbert Schlossberg's book, Idol for Destruction, or Idols for Destruction, or there's a book called Finding Truth, and they all have this, they're sort of Christian books that talk about the concept of things becoming idols in current culture. So that's kind of how I read your client's sort of view. It seemed to be a pretty mainstream Christian view of something being an idol. That's at least how I read it. So I didn't see it as being some sort of way out of mainstream as far as what lots of Christians believe, sort of maybe a current view. But one question I have for you, sort of building, sort of springboarding off of what Judge Bybee was asking. So I can't remember the name of the case. I always forget it. But the Muslim beer case that the Supreme Court had that Alito wrote do you think it would have made a difference if instead of saying my Muslim religion requires me to have a beard in prison versus saying if I was to shave off my beard, I would be taking on a false religion, which maybe we'd all be like, which that wouldn't make a lot of sense to us. But I never would have thought that would have necessarily made a difference as to whether his claim was cognizable. But do you think that makes a difference?
I don't think it makes a difference, Your Honor. I mean, I think it certainly and I agree with you that I'm not familiar with those books. I wouldn't at all be surprised if Lieutenant Colonel Dunn is intimately familiar with them. I'm certainly familiar with the concept, and it's something that I think in the Judeo-Christian tradition there's been a lot of idolatry as in the public sphere has been something that's been a big issue for 2,500, 3,000 years. I don't think it makes a difference as to the cognizability. Obviously, it's, you know, it helps you over the sincerity hump if you have something to draw upon, even if you're, you know, kind of on the edge of a religious tradition. I think that, again, speaking of names that I have cases I've forgotten, the Supreme Court's case in the mid-80s having to do with the Social Security number, the claimant didn't win that one, but Wabanaki, Native American tribe, and, you know, I don't think that was mainstream for Wabanaki or anybody else, but it was something that made sense and that was accepted as a sincere belief that warranted, you know, a pretty serious and deep opinion from the court, even though the claimant lost.
I've so far not contributed to this part of the discussion, but I have to say that I think at the way the case is now postured, with the government not having challenged the sincerity of the religious belief, we simply have to accept it, no matter what degree of skepticism one might have as to that. The government did indicate in front of the trial judge that it might later choose to challenge the sincerity, but it so far has not done so.
Yeah, and that's how I began my discussion of the merits oh so long ago, Your Honor, but I am always, you know, willing to and happy to discuss whatever is on the minds of the court. I think for purposes of decision, that's where we are, but, you know, knowing how one goes about deciding issues, you need to know what you need to know to feel comfortable, that you're doing the right thing. I know I've gone way over my time.
Yeah, counsel, let me ask my colleagues.
There are lots of issues I'd like to address, but it's at the court's indulgence now.
Yeah, so I think we'll give you some more time for rebuttal, I'm sure. But
I'm fine for now.
I think we've wore you out for now.
I hope not completely, Your Honor. Thank you.
We'll hear from the government.
Thank you, Your Honor. May it please the court, Sarah Carroll on behalf of the government, and with me at counsel table is Major Mark Nowak of the Air Force. I'd like to start, I think, with a question that Judge Bybee asked early in my colleague's argument, which is, what relief is he asking for? And I think it was pretty telling that plaintiff's counsel went directly to the conclusion of his reply brief. That is because plaintiff's request for relief has shifted pretty dramatically over the course of this litigation. In his TRO motion and in his opening brief in this court, he asked to be treated like a vaccinated person for purposes of training, travel, other operational decisions. So I think he made sort of a tactical decision to narrow his request for relief. That might be because after he filed his opening brief, this court and the Supreme Court denied his motions for an injunction pending appeal, and the Supreme Court granted the government's stay application in the Navy SEALs case. But for whatever reason, he is now trying to walk back from the relief he requested from the district court. But of course, the question on appeal is not whether, as a matter of some, you know, free-willing sense of equity, Lieutenant Colonel Dunn thinks there is something that this court should grant him in the first instance. The question is whether the district court abused its discretion in denying the TRO motion that was converted to a preliminary injunction motion that Lieutenant Colonel Dunn presented to the district court. That's very...
So, counsel, let me ask you about that, because in the Austin case that went up to the Supreme Court, that would seem to be the same sort of... That'd be true of the Austin case, but when it got to the Supreme Court basically said, the district court provided too much, gave too much relief, but we're gonna slim it down, but they didn't make it go away completely. So why wouldn't we be similarly positioned?
The difference in Austin is that the district court in that case had granted a very broad preliminary injunction. The government went to the Fifth Circuit and then the Supreme Court seeking only a partial stay of that injunction. We asked the Supreme Court and the Fifth Circuit to stay the injunction insofar as it required the Navy to, you know, deploy, assign, train people without regard to their vaccination status.
So isn't it true that, you know, that all happened sort of as this case was going along? And I think, did that happen after the district court had ruled the Supreme Court's stay? So isn't that sort of a subsequent legal development? I mean, it's hard for me to see how we should hold that against Lieutenant Colonel Dunn that he modified the relief he was requesting based on the Supreme Court decision that happened in the interim?
Well, I think that this case is in a very different posture than the Navy SEAL case. Again, the question is whether the district court abused its discretion. And Lieutenant Colonel Dunn is free to go back to the district court and seek a preliminary injunction in light of, you know, intervening precedent, including potentially the Navy SEAL case and anything else he wants to include in the record. But for these purposes, he can't, in his reply brief, without acknowledging it, he says, oh, I'm only asking for something very narrow, which is to be treated in this way that, you know, to be in sort of a limbo where I can potentially be open to assignments, even though the Air Force has decided that I'm not deployable.
If we thought that the district court might have been wrong, would we need to remand this on an open record?
I think if you think the district court might have been wrong,
actually, whether we thought the court was right or wrong, if things have changed so much, should we be sending this back to the district court to evaluate it in light of all the changes in the developments here?
I think that if the court thinks that things have changed in a material way, what the court should do is affirm the district court decision because, you know, as this court has emphasized in cases like National Wildlife Federation versus Burlington Northern Railroad, the question is whether the district court abused its discretion on the record before it. So I would advise the court in that instance to, you know, affirm the court could affirm in an unpublished decision if it wanted to, and then Mr. Dunn would be free to move for a request move for relief in the district court, taking account of whatever additional things he thinks have happened.
In light of Lieutenant Dunn having been relieved of his command, if we were to affirm the district court, what's going to happen to him? Is there a clear path here? Is he going to lose his benefits? Is he going to be drummed out of the military? There's just a lot of open questions here about what the military is going to do. So independent of Doster, because I want to take you to Doster in a minute.
Right.
But independent of Doster, if it's just this case and this case alone, what happens?
Independent of Doster, before the Doster PI was issued, he had been placed on no pay, no point status. As I understand it, he was in the process of being transferred to the Individual Ready Reserve, which is sort of a pool of people who are affiliated with the Air Force Reserve but are not, you know, actively participating in a unit. And he suggests that discharge is sort of foreordained once you're in the Individual Ready Reserve. That is not my understanding.
Is it only discharge that would affect the payment of his benefits, the accrual of his 20-year service?
I am not positive of the answer to that question, Your Honor, but I would. Yeah,
I thought the argument was that he stopped accruing towards the 20 years once he was in this independent ready reserve.
That might well be true, but if it is, it doesn't make a difference because this court has held very clearly in cases like Hardika that loss of retirement benefits, I think in Christofferson also, the service members there claimed that an action had been taken against them that would cause them to lose their retirement benefits, and this court said that that was not cause to grant a preliminary injunction.
I guess more to just the merits, would you agree that that would be a substantial burden under, not saying you're agreeing that RFRA, that he wins on his RFRA claim, but would you agree that that would be a substantial burden for purposes of RFRA?
We have not disputed for purposes of this case that Lieutenant Colonel Dunn has a sincerely held religious belief that is substantially burdened. We, of course, dispute very strongly whether the government has a compelling interest and whether...
So your argument is more towards the preliminary injunction factors like irreparable harm, et cetera, as far as that losing these benefits doesn't necessarily cause irreparable harm because at some point he could get paid money and made whole?
Yes, that is what I'm saying. I'm saying that he claims that that this court should grant him a preliminary injunction because he will be moved to this status, in which case he thinks, you know, the benefits of his service will not be the same. But there are robust means to seek review of that kind of thing in the Air Force, and he could take advantage of those things.
Does it matter, though, typically, and I know I'm talking about RFRA right now, so not the Free Exercise Clause, but does it matter that you know, he's got a religious liberty sort of claim he's making. So if he was to prevail on that, then the idea would be that the government would be impinging upon his religious liberty. Isn't that itself sort of an irreparable harm under our case law?
I don't think so, Your Honor, for a few reasons. First, I think I might be, this might not be directly responsive to what you were asking, but of course we think that that he does not have a valid religious liberty claim, and that the Air Force's requirement is valid under RFRA and under cases like Coalition for Economic Equity. A meritless constitutional or religious liberty claim does not qualify as irreparable injury or shift the balance of equities in the plaintiff's favor. But beyond that, he is saying that he is being threatened with various quintessentially remediable employment-related harms that this court, the Supreme Court, other courts have long held do not warrant a preliminary injunction. And the analysis does not change simply because he says, I'm being threatened to do those things unless I get vaccinated.
To be clear, that's all wrapped up, though, in the fact that he's saying that his religious liberty rights secured by the Constitution, but let's just focus on statute, are being impinged upon. And so if that were true, and I know you dispute that were true, but if that were true, it would be odd to me to think that, like, say, the military could be impinging upon a whole bunch of people's religious liberty rights, and that you wouldn't argue that that's some sort of irreparable harm. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, if you put it in some other context, if you were to say, you know, we're going to go make all the Muslim people shave off their beard or something like, wouldn't you acknowledge that that would be irreparable harm just because it's assuming that it is actually a religious liberty violation?
Well, I think that this case is different from some other religious liberty cases because here, no one is telling Lieutenant Colonel Dunn, you know, you cannot worship in the way you see fit. We are not letting you go to church or something like that. He's just being told, you know, we are requiring vaccination. You have a choice not to get vaccinated. And if you choose not to get vaccinated, there is a robust Air Force process to help, you know, to help you present your claims regarding.
But you can make the same argument and say, we have this idol you have to bow down to. It actually modeled off the one back in Daniel. And if you bow down to it, then you get to stay in the Air Force. We're not going to kill you and throw you in a fiery furnace or anything like that. We're just going to put you in ready reserve status if you don't bow down to this idol. Wouldn't you agree that, like, if that was the claim, that he would have irreparable harm?
Your Honor, I don't know that I'm prepared to opine on, you know, that particular hypothetical, but I think that I think that this court has long set a very high bar for irreparable harm.
Well, the reason I use that hypothetical is just because it sounded like you were saying, well, he's doing is just affecting his, he has to get vaccinated. If he doesn't, he suffers this burden. But I don't know, at the end of the day, it seems hard to say that that's not irreparable harm if, in fact, it is, you know, a religious liberty. It does violate RFRA. But, you know, I guess I'll just drop that.
Right. The last thing I'll say on that is that I think that Judge Smith's dissent from the Fifth Circuit's decision in Zambrano, which involved religious liberty claims not against the government but by employees of a private company, is pretty persuasive in explaining why the coercion theory that plaintiff is presenting here is not persuasive. But I think if it's okay with the court, move on to the merits. The Air Force, of course, has an extraordinarily compelling interest in maximizing the success of its military missions and in ensuring that it is reducing risks to the extent possible. The Air Force concluded that vaccination is the least restrictive means.
How come the military doesn't require people to get boosted?
Your Honor, you're right that boosters are not currently required. They could be required later, but boosters, it's an important point. Are fundamentally different from the primary series because under 10 U.S.C. 1107A, service members cannot be required, absent a presidential waiver, to take vaccines or drugs or other products that are not FDA approved. Boosters, unlike the primary series, currently do not have full FDA approval. They're subject to an emergency use authorization. So FDA approval is an important milestone that hasn't happened yet.
And that means that service members can't get the booster, or that they, or the military can't require it of them?
The military cannot require them unless, as I understand it, the president issues a waiver. So here the...
And I think that's also the answer to the contention or the objection that was made in Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's brief, that, well, if the military were so concerned about this, why didn't it require vaccines as soon as they were available? Well, it required them as soon as they were FDA approved.
Yes, you're absolutely right, Judge Fletcher. The day after the FDA approved the primary series, the Secretary of Defense ordered the primary series for service members.
The thing that, so you're saying that, well, we couldn't do this unless we got a presidential, unless we got this, the president signed off. I guess the question is, I guess, how does that relate to the analysis either under RFRA, under inclusiveness, narrow tailoring? I'm not sure that you could say, you know, if you said we're not requiring something because we haven't gotten, you know, we could get it, but we haven't gotten somebody to sign off on it. Do you think that would make it so that particular concern would not be something we could take into account for purposes of whether or not a law was generally applicable, or whether it was narrowly tailored?
I think the court should take into account that it is, you know, a serious matter to mandate that service members take something that is not FDA approved. It's not something that the Secretary of Defense lacks any authority to do, but it's, you know, it's a serious issue. And I think undisputed evidence is that the primary series of boosters of vaccines alone provide very significant protection against severe illness and death.
I agree with you, it's a serious matter, but I think you would agree with me that it's a serious matter. You know, people's religious objections to things is also a serious matter.
Yes, of course,
at least,
Your
I mean,
Honor.
You would agree with that, and obviously Congress does. And so the challenge is that the CDC has basically said that if you don't get boosted, you get very little benefit as far as not transmitting COVID. So CDC has said that. You're relying on the CDC's views about being vaccinated, but you know, CDC has also said that if you don't get boosted, that it doesn't provide much of a benefit. So there's sort of a disconnect between that and your view that we can't allow this person who's got natural immunity to not get vaccinated because we need to maximize people's immunity. There, you can see where there's sort of like a you start to wonder, you know, you're taking some of what the CDC says to but you're not this is a concern. What the CDC says, it doesn't actually provide much of a benefit to do what you're requiring people to do.
So a couple of responses, Your Honor. First, again, as I said at the beginning of the argument, the question here is whether the district court abused its discretion on the record that was before it. We acknowledge, of course, that, you know, the virus is evolving and that the CDC's guidance is evolving, and you know, we sent a letter to the court last week about that. But my first point is that in February, when the district court ruled on the preliminary injunction motion, the evidence about the virus was different. My second point is that even if the court thought for some reason that it should be taking subsequent developments into account, which I think would be contrary to the many cases in which this court says that it should not be doing that and should instead be looking at the record before the district court, the CDC continues to be clear that the primary series alone provides very strong protection. I'm not a scientist, so I don't want to say very strong because I don't know exactly what the numbers are, but that the primary series provides important protection against severe illness and death.
My understanding is what the CDC says is receipt of the primary series alone, in the absence of being up to date, the vaccination through receipt of all recommended booster doses provides a minimal protection against infection and transmission.
Yes, Your Honor. We acknowledge that things have changed with respect to infection and transmission, but the point that I'm trying to make is that a person who has received the primary series and nonetheless becomes infected is less likely to become severely ill and die as a result of COVID-19. And the record makes clear, it's kind of replete with explanations by the Air Force, that it is very important to ensure that service members...
I don't know that you dispute that a person who has natural immunity is less likely is let's put it differently, is more likely to have a less severe response if they to a subsequent infection of. And so then the question just becomes, under our standard of review, you know, what do we do with the fact that there's ambiguity here? I think your view is that we just defer, right, to the military, but there's a lot, you know, it is RFRA. I mean, we, if we just defer on religious liberty claims all the time, then RFRA becomes kind of meaningless.
Your Honor, a couple of responses, maybe first on the deference and then on the natural immunity. So on the deference point, I think the question you asked opposing counsel about what deference is owed, I think, was a very important one, because courts, of course, defer to the government on matters of sort of scientific and medical uncertainty. I think Chief Justice Roberts emphasized that, for one, in his South Bay decision, but courts say this a lot. I think this court has also said that, and the deference is...
Wait, call that. Chief Justice Roberts emphasized that in South Bay, but didn't he end up kind of losing that?
I think this was an earlier decision in South Bay.
But then he ended up dissenting later on, I believe.
Yes, you might be right, but this is a general principle that I am relying on, and yes, you're right that maybe that was not the...
I would go to Kavanaugh's decision if I were you.
Thank you, Your Honor. But the point I'm making is that it is kind of a basic principle that courts defer to the government on matters of scientific uncertainty, and the deference to where the military is involved is even greater. We are not saying that RFRA... is meaningless, and that we can that the military can make kind of unadorned assertions, and courts have no choice but to.
So can I ask you about that? Like, where is the line that we should draw? If you're not saying that, I know you're not saying that, and I'm, props to you for not saying it. It would be a bad argument if you said that. But I think what lines do we have that would make it so that RFRA is not meaningless in a context like this, right? What protection does RFRA provide?
RFRA requires the military, like other parts of the government, to satisfy the compelling interest test. But as Congress made clear when it enacted RFRA, Congress expected that in applying that test, it would be informed by the traditional deference that courts had always afforded to the military. Congress cited the Goldman decision, which said, courts should give significant weight to the military's weighing of interests and the military's judgments about, what interests are important. So strict scrutiny applies. We have not disputed that, and the Department of Defense's regulations and this whole accommodation process are based around that. But we are saying that on matters where the military is making judgments about what is necessary to accomplish its missions, to protect its people, and it is, at least whereas here, it is supporting those assertions with evidence. The Air Force submitted hundreds of pages of materials in this case. Courts should defer to that and should not be second-guessing, whether the risks that the military commanders have identified are really so significant or whether...
The best way for a court to sort of get in there and try to suss out whether or not you really believe what you're saying when you say those compelling interests are the exceptions, right? And that's why the test is set up to look at, exceptions. And so then that brings me back to, you heard me ask earlier about, you've got CDC guidelines that say it's safe for pregnant women to take this, but you've got a military that doesn't require them to do that. And it's hard not to come away with the impression that the military's just decided it's, they don't like, I don't know why. Why are they not requiring pregnant women to take something that CDC is safe, but then relying on the CDC guidance to say, these people have religious objections, have to take this?
So medical exemptions in the military are granted by medical providers. There is no, policy that such and such people get medical exemptions and such people don't. The Air Force recommends that pregnant service members get vaccinated, but a pregnant service member who has concerns can, of course, talk to her medical provider, and if her medical provider decides that she should have an exemption, that is, I think, viewed as something sort of within the medical provider's realm, but the record makes clear that DOD has instructed that medical exemptions should align with.
Aren't we sort of prioritizing medical providers over priests? You talk to your priest, and your priest says you shouldn't get this. I'm not saying that's what happened here, but so we're kind of creating it's starting to sound like Mr. like Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's concern about idols. Maybe we've sort of made medical providers sort of a sort of secular priesthood over here that gets deference from the military, but the actual traditional religious folks don't get any deference from the military.
Well, Your Honor, I want to be clear that the Air Force takes religious beliefs very seriously and is careful in assessing religious accommodations, but the fundamental difference between the temporary medical exemptions that the Air Force has been granting and the presumably permanent religious exemption that plaintiff wants here is that a person with a medical exemption remains unvaccinated for some period of time, some short period of time. During that time, they are not deployable, they're limited in their activities, but they are required to get vaccinated when the medical condition ends. So, you know, for example, someone, I think the CDC at least might, I think the CDC might still be saying, or at least used to say, that people who had a very recent COVID infection should delay vaccination for a while. So maybe someone in that situation would be given a medical exemption for some period of time, but then they would have to get vaccinated and they would return to their duties.
Yeah, no, on those ones, it's not much of an issue because that's where you're actually following CDC's guidance. It's the pregnant women that's tougher because there you're actually allowing an exemption when the CDC guidance goes the other way based on the fact that, well, a woman and her doctor should be able to make this decision, but you know, that's at that point you're prioritizing a person and their medical professional over a person and their religious, you know, their religious conscience or their religious.
But of course, if you're doing it as a deferring to the medical, there's no religion involved in the medical advice. It's purely a medical decision, and the Air Force has decided that in individual cases of pregnant women, in consultation with her doctor, that's a scientific decision. I mean, they're just in two different realms.
Yes, that's right, Your Honor. There is no religion involved, and this is based on an objective analysis of the impact that an exemption would have on the military's compelling interests. Again, a short exemption while someone has a medical condition or while someone's potentially a pregnant woman's medical provider is telling her, yes, you should not get vaccinated, is different from granting someone an indefinite.
So in like the Muslim beard case in prisons, as I recall, they allowed people to grow a short beard if there was a medical rationale for that, right? So I think it's like dermatitis or something like that, they needed a shaving cause some sort of medical issue. But as I recall, that was the exception that you looked at to say, why aren't you treating religious people differently? I mean, is it really the government's position that science gets treated different than like science gets prioritized and gets an exemption, but we're not going to give anything that's based on science doesn't count as an exemption that we would take into consideration when doing the second stage of the RFRA test?
No, Your Honor. I want to be very clear that the government is not prioritizing science over religion or vice versa. What it is doing is it is looking at individual exemption requests that come to it and assessing how they would affect its interests. So in Holt v. Hobbs, I think as Your Honor was referring to.
So what percentage of women that are pregnant that ask for an exemption during the pregnancy get an exemption? Do you know?
I don't know the answer to
that.
But
it's a pretty high percentage, I would assume.
I don't know.
Are there any medical exemptions that are granted that are permanent?
In the context of the COVID-19 vaccine, no. There are not. I understand that maybe for some other things that are not involved in this case, I don't know what those are. There may be a possibility of a permanent exemption, but in the case of COVID-19 vaccines, no.
Now, to make sure I understand that, my understanding is it's also true that there's no religious liberty exemption or religious exemption that's permanent in a sense too, right? Because I think I remember seeing somewhere that they say that it can be reconsidered, you know, in case your religious views changed or something, you can't just keep the exemption if you no longer have the religious views. So I'm trying to figure out, like, to what extent, I mean, maybe no exemption is technically permanent because it can always be reconsidered if your situation has changed, whether your religious beliefs or your medical condition. But is it true that maybe you might have a medical condition that, you know, say an allergy to something in the vaccine, it wouldn't be a permanent exemption, but as a practical matter, it would be permanent?
So there were a couple of things wrapped up in that I want to respond to. First, under DOD instruction 1300.17, religious exemptions are presumptively permanent. They follow a service member from assignment to assignment, post to post. They can be rescinded, but the default is that they are not. And as for your question about whether there could be a person with a perpetual medical exemption, under DOD instruction 1332.45, anyone who is non-deployable for 12 consecutive months and a person who is unvaccinated against COVID or something else for any reason is considered is generally considered non-deployable. Then after 12 consecutive months, that person is reevaluated for whether they should be retained in the force. So there is no reason to think that someone who's, for example, allergic to the vaccine will just sort of hang out with a medical exemption for a very long time.
Let me let me fast forward. At the very end, you said there's no reason to think that they will hang out. It sounded, I mean, I thought you were going to say, well, you know, they'll be reevaluated in 12 months, but presumably, assuming they're still allergic, they would just get another 12-month exemption. Is that right? Or you're saying they'll kick them out?
No, I'm saying that they will be reevaluated for their retention in the force. When someone has a temporary medical exemption that expires, I understand that it is considered whether the exemption should be reviewed, but separately from that, if someone is non-deployable for 12 consecutive months, the Air Force looks at whether they should be retained or whether they should be...
Okay, but this is really important, actually, because it sounds to me like you're saying no medical exemptions are permanent, but it also seems extremely odd to me that if somebody had a condition that made it so they could never get the COVID vaccine because it's allergic, I'm not a doctor, but this, yes, they'll be reviewed every 12 months, but I don't think in 12 months they're going to, like, make them take it. So it seems like practically it'll be permanent, even if technically it needs to be reviewed every 12 months.
Your Honor, I don't know exactly how these things work in practice, but I think that what might happen after 12 months is that the Air Force would look at the person and say, okay, you are unable to satisfy this thing that's a requirement for you to deploy, and the point of the reserves is to deploy, so this is not working out for you anymore, so we will move you to the IRR, or we will discharge you, or we will take whatever the appropriate steps are.
I see. You're saying they will kick them out after. You're not sure about that, but you're thinking maybe they would kick them out if they couldn't get over their reason for not to take it. They might get kicked out.
They are evaluated for whether they... I don't know, I don't have an empirical number, so I don't want to, get ahead of myself and say something that might not be true as an empirical matter, but they will be evaluated for whether they should remain in the Air Force Reserve.
Counsel, a couple questions. So first of all, with respect to the interaction of the natural immunity and the vaccine, do you agree with opposing counsel's characterization of the medical evidence on what the effectiveness is of having the belt and the suspenders?
Your Honor, I do not agree with opposing counsel's characterization. We don't dispute that prior infection has some effect, but I think a few important points that you sort of hit on in your questions are, number one, there is uncertainty about that. Number two, there is no FDA-approved test or anything to test whether someone has natural immunity. Plaintiff seems to think it's like an on or off switch, and he says, okay, I was infected well over a year ago, and now the switch is on, and I have natural immunity, and therefore I'm as protected as a vaccinated person. But there is significant question about the duration of protection. And in addition, there is evidence that vaccination provides added protection to people with prior infections. You can look at ER 354 for that, and the CDC has also consistently been saying that. So I think it is absolutely within the military's authority.
How does that interact with the more recent statement by the CDC that if you haven't been boosted, though, it doesn't give you, you see what I'm saying? So like if they haven't been, if somebody that's been vaccinated, if the argument is if you both have natural immunity and you've been vaccinated, then maybe you're better off than somebody that's been vaccinated. But if somebody just has natural immunity. But if you've had natural immunity but you've been vaccinated but you haven't been boosted, how does that interplay with this statement by the CDC and the most recent guidance?
The most recent CDC statement that we brought to the court's attention in our letter continued to emphasize that for people who have previously been infected, vaccination is still important. And I don't recall.
Are they talking about full vaccination?
I don't remember for sure, Your Honor. I think it's possible that it said only the primary series was helpful. Having just the primary series was still helpful if you've had a prior infection. But I think, vaccination in general, as a general matter, the CDC has concluded helps prevent, at minimum, against severe illness and death for people who have a prior infection.
Let me ask you this. I understand that there is a process by which the Air Force does address religious objections, and I gather has granted a few, not very many, but a few. What do those look like?
So as of mid-July, the Air Force had granted 135 religious exemptions, and There is not information in the record about how those work or what they look like. So I'm not sure that I can provide the court with much information about that.
I can imagine, for example, I mean, this is my imagining rather than anything I know on the record, that perhaps someone, a Christian Scientist, might be given an exemption. Do we know why Lieutenant Colonel Dunn was not given a religious exemption?
Yes, we do know, because he based on, you know, the nature of his role and his expertise, the Air Force concluded that it would jeopardize the compelling interest in reducing the risk that, for example, a service member would be deployed abroad in connection with a sensitive military assignment and then get seriously ill.
So it was based not on any sense that the religious objection was insincere, but rather on the role that he was serving.
That's absolutely right, Your Honor.
Well, if that's so, if the government is willing to say that this is a sincere objection, why is he not entitled to whatever accommodations those others got who did have religious objections that were granted?
So the analysis depends on the individual circumstances, of course, as plaintiff insists is necessary. This is not in the record. And I don't want to be too definitive because I don't know all the facts, but my understanding is that many of the people who have gotten religious exemptions are people that are, for example, getting ready to retire or separate from the Air Force. And in that kind of scenario, you can see why it would not affect the Air Force's compelling interests in readiness so significantly if they weren't vaccinated for, say, their last few months of service.
And how much do we have in the record to substantiate what you just said, that the reason that the class of people who are given exemptions are really classes of people who are on their way out?
That is not in the record, Your Honor.
Okay. Is it in? I remember reading it, and so yeah. I don't remember where I read that.
Yeah, I read it too.
Did I read it in one of the other opinions or something like that from some district court somewhere?
Yes, I think plaintiff relies on something that a court said in a different case.
But if that's true, then, I mean, it really is kind of, we're kind of back to that you know, you got this sort of unique little group of people that are, you know, they're basically out the door almost, and so you're willing to give them a couple extra weeks, you know, to accommodate them. But that really is a different, if that's true, then you really aren't granting religious exemptions for anybody that's at all similarly situated to Lieutenant Dunn.
Again, I don't know all the details, so I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but I wouldn't be especially surprised if people who are similarly situated to Lieutenant Colonel Dunn are not getting religious exemptions because his not being vaccinated, the military has concluded, would imperil compelling interests in ensuring
But that role has changed now based on his intemperate response to the direct order for which he lost his command. If Lieutenant Dunn were to apply today, would the Air Force balance this differently? And do we have an obligation to balance this differently, depending on whether he's in charge of the command, which he was at the time the complaint was filed, or that he's not in charge of the command, which is our situation today?
So this court certainly does not have the obligation to do that balancing in the first instance. That is, of course, as I've said, you know, what matters is what was before the district court when the district court ruled.
And he was still in charge of that command at the time the district court ruled, is that correct?
He had just been relieved of command when the district court ruled, but I think he was still attached to that unit that deploys on short notice to set up airstrips in austere locations.
And he's no longer affiliated with that unit.
That's true. So one thing that I want to make clear is that it's true that in light of the Doster PI, Lieutenant Colonel Dunn has been removed from no pay, no point status. I understand that he participated in training earlier this month. I'm told that he opted to participate in online training, so he did an online training session. But I don't think it's right, and we'd be happy to submit something to the court on this if it would be helpful. I don't think that what he's doing right now is a new assignment. I don't think he's been assigned to a new role. He's being given some duties because the Air Force is required to comply with the Doster PI, but this is not sort of how the Air Force would allocate its resources.
Okay, so if Doster were not a factor and we were to affirm the district court, what would the Air Force do?
He would, I think that consistent with Air Force policy, he would be, Lieutenant Colonel Dunn would be processed to the IRR, where he could, if he became medically ready at some point down the road, he could apply to rejoin a unit in the active reserve, but he would be in the IRR.
And that means what? That he loses his retirement?
That I believe that's right. But he, I would emphasize that, number one, that is not an irreparable harm for purposes of a preliminary injunction. And number two, I guess sort of relatedly, that is the kind of thing that someone can challenge before the Air Force Board for the correction of military records. If he thinks that he was wrongly moved to the IRR, he has robust mechanisms within the Air Force for trying to get compensated.
So did the district, when the district court did its balancing, just remind me, I've read the district court's opinion, but if the district court, when the district court did its balancing, did it balance the government's compelling interest by weighing the position in which Lieutenant Dunn previously was, as commander of this special squadron?
I don't think that the district court's decision, the district court might have mentioned the fact that he had been in command, but I don't think the district court's reasoning was limited to that. I think the district court was saying the Air Force Reserve has to deploy people abroad to do really important military things.
Right, but that would be a very different kind of thing. I mean, you're suggesting that the compelling government interest really does turn upon what role they occupy as opposed to some general question of military readiness.
I think there is we are relying on a general interest in military readiness, but I think we are also pointing out that because of the nature of what Lieutenant Colonel Dunn did and what everyone in the reserves is expected to do, which is deploy.
Would the Air Force have considered his application differently if he had been an Air Force recruiter in downtown Sacramento?
I don't know, Your Honor. I don't know, but I know that he has been in the Air Force reserves.
The Air Force took into account people who were just about on their way out in terms of exemptions, right? You told us that.
Yes, certainly the Air Force would consider all of the circumstances. I don't know if the Air Force's ultimate decision would be different, but the Air Force is looking at the particular circumstances as evidenced by the references in his decision documents in this case.
Yeah, so I didn't understand that either the district court or even that the government's argument really turned in this case or any of the other cases that I've read, they really turned on sort of the specifics of any particular person's role. Sort of as you've kind of talked about a little bit this morning, that like, you know, that this person had this one role and it wouldn't make sense to have this person. I understood the decisions to be a lot more general, that we need to have a force that's ready and that we have this general policy and so is that, am I right in understanding that? In other words, I'm not sure it would make sense for us to affirm the district court based on his specific role that he had. Sounds like didn't even have at the time when a district court actually ruled, but had before. But my understanding was the government was relying on a more generalized rationale that would basically relate to anybody. When I say similarly situated to Lieutenant Colonel Dunn, I didn't mean earlier similarly situated, and I just meant similarly situated in the sense of not having a foot out the door. Like other than that, just having some sort of religious objection. I understood that the rationale was sort of broadly applicable, the government's rationale.
The rationale for requiring vaccination is that a vaccinated and healthy force is necessary. In assessing whether individuals should be given exemptions from the requirement, the military looks at the duties.
No, but this is important. Is that really true? Because my understanding is that this argument has been made to a lot of district courts and around the country. And that they seem to be rejecting the idea based on the fact that there doesn't seem to be any evidence other than, as we talked about earlier, this one unique situation where people are basically mostly out the door, that the government is giving some people because they're a desk jockey, but other people that have a position like lieutenant, you think the government is actually drawing those distinctions and making these decisions? Is there evidence of that? Because my understanding is there isn't.
There is evidence that in deciding these requests, the military looks at people's individual circumstances.
But if they look at their individual circumstances and always reach the same result, unless they have a foot out the door because they're retiring, you can call it an individualized inquiry, but that would be like saying we make an individualized inquiry for every woman who's pregnant, but we always make them get the vaccine. It wouldn't be very compelling. That's what I'm struggling with. Like, you can call it an individualized inquiry, but if you reach the same result all the time, then maybe it's individualized inquiry, but whatever rationale that they're relying on always overrides their individual circumstances.
I think the sort of issue that Your Honor is identifying stems from the nature of the military's compelling interests here, that there will not be a lot of people in for whom the military does not think it has a compelling interest in requiring vaccination.
Which sounds as though the individualized inquiry is, at least if we can assume that the reason some people are getting religious exemptions is that they're on their way out the door. And we don't really know that, but I'm assuming that that's what happened, and that's the only reason it happens. Well, we're getting an individual inquiry as to whether or not that's the case. That is to say, are they on their way out the door? If they're not on their way out the door, the Air Force has then decided that anyone who's serving in a continuing capacity who's not very near retirement, we need to have vaccinated because we need the flexibility of assignment. We need this then they'll have a long, long list as to why they need to do that. That's an individualized inquiry as to one factor. Sure.
I think
that doesn't mean it's not an individualized inquiry. It just means there's only one factor that's relevant.
Right. If what you're in under the situation you're hypothesizing, I think that is true. It would be an individualized inquiry, and the military would have plenty of rationales, which it has explained in the voluminous record here, for why everyone who is going to be deploying, and plaintiff is a bomber pilot. That is what he is trained in, and it's very easy to imagine a situation in which a bomber pilot becoming severely ill could have catastrophic effects.
But you keep doing that, right? You keep doing that. You keep coming back to that, but it does sound like you're kind of acknowledging what Judge Fletcher was just saying, which is it doesn't really matter that he's a bomber pilot. It doesn't matter. All that matters for purposes of his quote-unquote individualized inquiry was whether or not he had a foot out the door for purposes of retirement. But if it didn't actually make a difference whether he's a bomber pilot or a paper pusher, then it does seem, you can understand from my perspective, it seems like it's unfair to kind of rely on the fact that he's a bomber pilot when it really didn't influence the government's decision at all. You're kind of, it's playing a bit of a shell game as far as pretending like that's part of what we take into account with an individualized inquiry, but it seems like you've almost acknowledged that you don't actually take that into account. You only take account that they have a foot out the door.
I think that the question in this case, as plaintiff emphasizes very heavily in his briefs under RFRA, is whether under his particular circumstances the government vaccination is the least restrictive means of achieving compelling government interests. And if plaintiff or if Your Honor has questions about whether there is some other person out there working at a desk somewhere who perhaps should receive a religious exemption because that person's severe illness might not jeopardize military interests as much as plaintiffs might. If there were questions about that, that would not be a reason to hold that RFRA entitled plaintiff to a religious exemption.
Unless this fellow was willing to accept the desk job, right? Which he is now. Now you have your arguments to the fact that we shouldn't take that into account. We should. But if he's willing to accept the desk job, then he really is kind of not really differently situated than the person who was working at the desk job. And it's just happy to sit there and push paper for a year and a half until he can get to his 20 years and then be pushed out.
Your Honor, I think that the line of reasoning gets pretty close to it crosses the line into judicial second-guessing of military assignments, which, as this court held in Schlanger v. United States, and as the Supreme Court said in Orloff, courts are not supposed to be doing that. Courts are not supposed to be saying, hey, military, we know that you think this person with clerical training
you're,
would
the one
be,
that was sort of saying that, well, it would be a different situation if he was a, not to use the word desk jockey, you'd say, but if he was a desk jockey, it would be a different situation, but he's a fighter pilot, or he's an airplane pilot. All I'm saying is, All I'm saying is it doesn't seem like that played any role in the government's decision. And if there doesn't seem like it played any role in the government's decision, I mean, it's really odd for us to write a decision that relies on something that played nothing, that had nothing to do with the government's decision.
I don't think it's true that it played no role in the government's decision. The decision letters here explicitly reference plaintiff's duties. And I think if the military is deciding we want someone with a lot of clerical expertise to be doing the jobs at a desk and we want bomber pilots to be doing bomber pilot things, that is an entirely legitimate thing for the judiciary to be doing, or for the military to be doing.
Yeah, no, I read that letter. It did specifically did refer to the things that he was doing. Now, his side says that's boilerplate. Well, I'm not sure it's boilerplate or not, but it does reference the specific tasks that he does in the Air Force.
That's true, and of course the military is entitled to a presumption of regularity. It would be kind of extraordinary, as plaintiff suggests, to think that the Air Force Surgeon General was essentially lying when he said in that document that he took plaintiff's individual circumstances into account. So
what role should we put on the fact that, I mean, you know, you can see all these judges around the country are finding it fairly, you know, they're troubled by the fact that the government doesn't seem to have granted any of these except for the people that already have a foot out the door, or very few, you know. And it sounds to me like you're arguing that we should just start to ignore that and sort of focus on, which I don't know why I would do that, try to figure out whether or not I think they could have made an exception for a pilot, right? That would force me to sort of make decisions that only the military's. But that doesn't, should we just not, if it's true that there's been thousands of requests and very few granted, and it appears like all or almost all of the ones that were granted fall in this little side category that's not applicable, is that not something we should take into account?
I do not think that that has a direct bearing on whether the military has a compelling interest in requiring that this plaintiff be vaccinated. But one thing
that a little bit of a bearing on, though, is like the individualized inquiry, right? Like if you keep saying we give them an individualized inquiry, but it looks like it's just a thing you go through, but you always reach the same result. You know, should we not take that into account?
I don't think that that is directly relevant, and I want to emphasize that you're right, Your Honor, that there have been a lot of cases challenging denials of religious exemptions in the military, but I don't want the court to have the impression that every court has been ruling against the government. There have been a lot of cases. We have won a lot of cases. We are, I'm an appellate lawyer, and there are lots of cases where we are the appellee right now. The Supreme Court denied an injunction pending appeal in this case. A lot of courts have looked at this and correctly recognized the military has a compelling interest in ensuring that it can complete its missions and requiring, based on evidence.
Let me ask you something that just occurred to me so does it matter whether you're giving them an individualized inquiry? Because, and here's why I'm asking, I'll just lay my cards on the table. If I think that you're not really giving an individualized, the military is not giving an individualized inquiry because it's really pretending to give an individualized inquiry, but the only thing that can make a difference is whether or not they have a foot out the door. Like if I was to think that, then you would lose unless it just doesn't matter whether they're giving an individualized. In other words, could the military just have a policy that we are going to deny all religious exemptions? Could the military, because that's actually kind of, I haven't thought about it, but is your position that the military could just have that policy? This is important enough that we're going to deny all religious exemptions. But if you're about ready to retire, talk to us. Could you have that policy?
So RFRA requires that the government be able to demonstrate in court that a substantial burden on a religious belief is the least restrictive means of furthering a compelling government interest. So in such a policy, if the government could go to court and show that it satisfied that test with respect to all of the people at issue, then there would be no RFRA problem. This is not,
So if you could meet the fact that it's narrowly tailored enough, even if it was across the board, you don't get an exemption, then you'd be okay. But if you need to have individualized exemptions, an individualized inquiry process in order to meet the narrowly tailored, then you also, I think, would follow that you have to have a meaningful individualized inquiry process, right? That it's not just a, it's not something you just go through.
I don't think that, I'm not sure that's the right way to look at it, Your Honor. I think if there were a blanket policy, but there were some individual service member who could go to court and say, they applied the policy to me, but as to me, you know, there is no compelling interest in requiring such and such a thing. I think that that person would win, but it wouldn't be because of, you know, the adequacy of the agency's explanation in denying the religious exemption request or something. It would be because the person was entitled to relief under RFRA. This is not, you know, an APA case in which courts are looking at the adequacy of the agency's reasoning. The question is whether, with respect to an individual claim, the government in court can carry its burden under RFRA.
Right, so I think, if I'm following you, you are basically saying we do have to give them an individualized inquiry because we have to give them an opportunity to at least tell us what those things would be, and we have to look at it to see if it's narrowly tailored. And then what you're saying is it's more substance than procedure. It's not just that we have to go through, but the substance of our analysis has to be that we actually are narrowly tailored within the meaning of.
I don't think there's any, aside from the extensive procedures set out by Air Force and DOD regulations, I don't think there are any particular procedural limits on how the military can assess religious exemption requests. But I think that if the military were engaged in a process in which, you know, it didn't give people an opportunity to bring forward individual circumstances, then it wouldn't be, you know, then it wouldn't have an opportunity to consider things that might be relevant later in court.
And you're saying it might win, but it would only win because it's still narrowly tailored enough that by the time you got to court, they wouldn't be able to show that it wasn't narrowly tailored enough. But I think I'm following you. But yeah, okay, I think I'm following you.
If I can change gears, what are we supposed to do about Doster?
So in our view, as we said in our letter to the court, you know, plaintiff is not entitled to two bites at the apple. Under this court's decision in Crawford v. Bell, for example, the court explained that an individual cannot pursue claims that are also being pursued by a class of which.
Now, so why is that so? Because the ordinary rule is, in our rather awkward American system, that we can have parallel litigation with the same parties in different courts. It's wasteful, but they get to do it. I mean, what's different about this case?
I think that what's different about this is that in the context of class actions, this court has said that where a class is pursuing relief and the plaintiff is a member of the class, the plaintiff cannot also pursue an individual claim. And I don't know exactly what the doctrinal...
Has that question been briefed to us?
No, it has not been briefed.
That might be useful.
We would be happy to submit something.
Can I ask a follow-up question to Judge Fletcher's? And it kind of goes back to a question he was asking your opposing counsel, which is, so assume for a second that he's right that you can follow dual tracks. You know, you can be part of a class, but and maybe there's like a race to the final decision, and that one gets res judicata. The question I've got is there some sort of rule that you have to allow that to happen, or can the one court be allowed to stay as a matter of our discretion? So in other words, put that concretely in this case, like could we, I got the impression maybe Judge Fletcher was saying that he might, that he was at least putting out there the idea that like we just could not, like we were not allowed to stay the case. But I'm not sure, on one end there's the, we can have dual tracks, on the other end is like we couldn't have dual tracks, and then somewhere in the middle would be we could have dual tracks, but the one court has discretion to stay. Is that not an option to us, or the middle one?
I don't know of anything that would preclude the court from choosing the middle option. Indeed, the 11th Circuit, I think, recently stayed an appeal in another Air Force vaccination case. So I think if this court wanted to, if the court thought that that was the best way to do it, I think that would be available.
So if he can't pursue claims in two courts, who wins? The first filed suit? The one that has the lowest... is the lowest on the level of abstraction, which would probably be this suit as opposed to the Doster suit, where he's just simply a class action member.
I think that
what's the rule? What's the rule of default?
I don't know if I have a full doctrinal answer for Your Honor, but I think that the Doster court provided an opt out mechanism, and I think that if our position is that if Lieutenant Colonel Dunn does not want to go with the Doster option, he should take advantage of that
option. And if he doesn't, then we should stay our hand?
I think that would certainly be an appropriate thing.
If he doesn't opt out, then he should just stick with Doster.
Yes, that's what we
think. And we should pull back.
I certainly think it would be appropriate for this court to stay this appeal. I think it would be appropriate for Mr. Dunn to dismiss this case without prejudice to his ability to refile it if the Doster class ends up eventually being decertified.
Can I ask you a follow-up question? Because he does make the argument that he's making some additional arguments that are being able to be made in Doster, such as the natural immunity. But most of his argument, a lot of it, is sort of the same argument, I'm assuming, as in Doster. So if he lost in Doster, ultimately, like presumably he wouldn't be able to come back here and re-argue those issues here, because they're res judicata. Could he argue anything? Could he argue the pieces that he was not able to make over there because he was not able to make them?
I think he could assert new claims. So in cases looking at sort of parallel class actions and individual claims, this court has said that, for example, if there's a class action pursuing systemic prison relief, an individual inmate who is a member of that class can file suit and assert individual claims for relief that are about different things. But I don't think that Mr. Dunn could assert the same, RFRA First Amendment claim that has been asserted in Doster. And if he thinks that the Doster...
practical matter, could he assert a RFRA claim based on natural immunity? Because presumably the RFRA claim's already been assert in Doster, but not necessarily the specific RFRA claim based on natural immunity. So he'd just be limited to that little piece is what he could litigate here?
I think the natural immunity thing is more an argument in support of a claim. I think it actually, I'm not totally sure that it's true that Doster does not involve arguments about natural immunity. I was looking at the stay briefing and it talked about natural immunity some, but even putting that aside, I think that he would be precluded from making a RFRA claim that relied on natural immunity. And I think that if he thinks that the Doster class is not adequately representing his interests because they're not making all the arguments that he thinks should be made, that is perhaps an argument that Doster should not be a class action, which of course we're arguing to the Sixth Circuit, or that might be a reason why he might choose to opt out of the Doster class and instead proceed with this case where he can make his individualized arguments.
What's the briefing schedule in the Sixth Circuit?
We have a fully briefed stay motion. We filed the reply in support of the stay this past Friday, and at least when I checked my email before this session, hadn't yet received a decision, and I don't think there is a merits briefing scheduled yet.
And that's just a motions panel of the Sixth Circuit?
Yes.
Yeah. I'm inclined to think I'd like some more briefing on this Doster question. I mean, we're talking about a lot of things, and we kind of have some ideas. But you say, for example, that a class action is different from parallel individual cases, which may well be true, but I'm not sure of that as I sit here. Yeah.
Right, and I have not. I've read some cases that support the point I'm making in the class action context, but I haven't exhaustively canvassed the individual
cases. And there's a
fair
amount of case law on abstention where judges say, I'm just going to hold back and mm-hmm. because something else is going forward.
Right.
And these tend to be cases, the ones that I remember, that don't involve one of them being a class action.
Right.
Judges do it a lot, or at least they do it sometimes, but in the reported cases where it's litigated, where the party says, no, I want to go forward, the answer tends to be the judge is required to go forward.
Hmm.
So I wouldn't mind some briefing on some of this.
Why don't we craft an order just in case there are additional questions that we want briefed?
Yeah.
We might give you an order on this, and I guess as part of that we might ask to what Judge Fletcher was saying was where the parties are saying I want to go forward, but as I recall from the last Rule 28J letter, it was a little ambiguous in my mind whether or not Lieutenant Colonel Dunn necessarily wants to go forward. So we may ask for you to make that super clear, too. We'll talk about that amongst ourselves. But I see you've gone a little bit over.
I think this is my longest argument ever.
Okay. But thank you. You can count this as two arguments in your tally, both of you. But I think we'll give your opposing counsel a little time for rebuttal here. And Thank you very much.
Thank you,
counsel.
Your Honor.
And I think maybe we'll just put a few minutes on, but I'm we'll stop asking questions when my two colleagues are done asking questions.
Okay. Well, if I get just a minute before you break in, I'd first like to say about irreparable harm that this is, I think this falls squarely into the line of cases that say that impingement on First Amendment freedoms, including free exercise, works irreparable harm. And Ramirez...
Does it matter if we're talking about the RFRA claim that's not technically First Amendment, but...
It's First Amendment freedoms is what the cases say, and I think Ramirez, which is a it's RLUIPA, but it's essentially a RFRA claim, found irreparable harm there, and now it's not clear. They did it in about
it's not like a case where the government is actually suppressing speech. That is that they're physically preventing you from uttering something. He's not being prevented from going to church. He's not being compelled. He's not being forced against his will to get the vaccine.
Well, he is being forced to choose between serving his country and serving his God, Your Honor. And I think there are a fair number of cases that recognize that kind of compulsion is exactly the type of irreparable harm that RFRA and the Free Exercise Clause are directed at. And I think the Sombrano decision, the majority rather than dissent, and Judge Ho's concurrence with the denial of rehearing en banc, which we spared you a 28J on, but confident your clerks have probably already found, it explains that, as does Judge Ho's earlier dissent from a denial on an earlier motions panel denial earlier on, that this kind of choice is exactly the type of impingement on First Amendment freedoms that is an irreparable harm. And also, just on the side point, Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's 19-year career and steady promotions, even if he gets some economics back through review board or whatever else he might go to, his chance at progressing is in danger here, and it's irreparable danger if he is forced out for whatever reason, in no assignment or inadequate assignment or whatever else the military may seize upon. If he's got an injunction in place and he's being treated adequately, then at least he has a chance. Maybe not this promotion board, given what's gone down. He's missed some duty on no points, no pay, but if he remains on duty, he maybe gets that fair shot at full bird colonel, especially if he wins in the permanent proceedings, which is another reason why this shouldn't go back down for more preliminary proceedings, but he should get the protections now and let the permanent injunction proceedings go forward. Let's get a resolution on this case. I'm not going to enter the Doster issue because I have a very strong suspicion we're going to get a detailed order on future topics to address. Happy, obviously, to respond to questions on that. One thing I'd like to make clear, and I think it's very hard for all of us to keep these separate, is that, again, we're not saying that the government doesn't have a right to impose the vaccine mandate the way they impose it. They can draw the line wherever they want to draw the line, and we're not challenging their ability to impose the mandate. What we're challenging and what we're saying has to be addressed is the vaccine mandate as it is now, for whatever reason, how that lines up against Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's natural immunity, and what does that mean in terms of the least restrictive means to meet their legitimate end in keeping him healthy. But that legitimate end has to be taken, that has to take his condition into account, which they haven't spent any time figuring out, and they should. They talk about serious illness, granted, the court can't get into the specific assignments, but serious illness is not an issue. At least the CDC says it's considerably reduced, whether it's vaccination or prior infection. That's who he is. He's got the same, and by most accounts, a better chance of having a milder illness should he get COVID again than someone who's gone through one or even more rounds of vaccination. As the unfortunate history of Lord knows how many people from the commander-in-chief on down that we have seen, people get sick again, but it's not a big deal. It's the sort of thing the military has been dealing with every day for 250 years. Finally, the justifications that have been offered have been one thing or the other. One has been the very broad, healthy fighting force readiness, keeping, you know, immunization generally, and again, I think the interest is in immunity rather than immunization. On the other hand, directed at something that's no longer in the case, which was Colonel Dunn's former command. Now, you know, I might think that the military should reevaluate its position as to what he can do, but that's not something this court can look at. What this court can look at is...
Counsel, what about government's position that we're sort of locked into where this case was? So some of these things that we've been sent, like the CDC's most recent guidance and what's happened since, that none of that matters because what we're looking at is the district court's order and what was before the district court when it issued its order.
Well, I don't think that's... I think the district court's analysis doesn't satisfy RFRA for all the reasons that are in our brief, and I do think the government submitted the CDC, the latest CDC guidance, and I think it's remarkable that they're saying here the court should disregard it. I think the court can look at the record. I think we come out the same place on the district court record, but we're looking here several months later. Lieutenant Colonel Dunn's already had many months between the end of interim relief here and the entry, however broad and however long or short-lived it might be in Doster, of being on no points, no pay, and one foot towards the individual ready reserve. I think the court, looking at preliminary relief, because remember, we are just talking about preliminary relief. There will be a full record. We went in there on a TRO, just pulling declarations out of other cases and doing what we could do on no time, hoping to get a standstill order or at least keep Lieutenant Colonel Dunn in the force. Preliminary injunction is going to have all this stuff played out and should be at that stage, not another preliminary injunction. The permanent injunction proceeding will have all that played out. I think this court, in looking at preliminary relief, can look at anything that's been placed in front of it. And we have an ample record, and the two parties have submitted other, obviously plenty of 28J letters, but a couple of them, particularly what the government just submitted and now is walking away from, address the record.
So I think that's a helpful answer. Similarly, what about this idea of, so many people have asked for exemptions, certain number of exemptions have been granted, it's not super clear, maybe not on our record especially, it's not clear like what the reasons were for those exemptions. What do we do with all of that? You know, you heard our conversation with your opposing counsel about, how much, what does the record show that we have in front of us or that we can rely on as far as what the basis for those exemptions were? Has anybody who doesn't have a foot out the door been granted an exemption? Is that in this record?
Your Honor, what is in the record, and it's stale, so I don't know. Like my friend, I don't really know exactly what's happened it sounds like a few dozen exemptions have been granted since then. And there was, I believe it was a declaration from another case. It's in the record. We can try to find it. I wasn't able to locate it when I was trying to keep track of what was going on. But there is Your Honor did remember something. There's something in there, but it's several months ago, testimony in one of the other cases that said everyone was somebody with a foot out, with the foot out the door within 180 days, I believe. And I believe there may actually be testimony in this record by one of the government's witnesses that characterizes the religious exemptions that have been granted as a subset of administrative exemptions that are limited to those circumstances. I believe there is a declaration in this record that says that. But then, of course, that's also, it's a February, I believe, declaration, and I can't speak to what's happened since what's in the record. I just don't know.
Questions? No. All right. Well, I think we're about ready to let you free. So thank you, counsel, both. And this was a very long argument, but it was very helpful. And as you can tell, we had a lot of questions. And both sides have been very helpful in this case. So thank you very much. And we'll take this case under submission. And that ends our argument calendar for today.
Thank you, Your Honor.